If you have your Bibles, open them up to Matthew chapter 19, please. Let's pray. Father, thank you for today. Thank you that I love how you speak to David, and Father, how he chooses these songs, and Father, how they fit. And Lord, it's just a confirmation that your will is wanting to unfold in our hearts. And Father, I just pray especially today in these next few minutes that Father, you would interrupt our habit and rhythm of what we do in church. And Father, truly speak deep down into our souls. Father, the subject at hand is foundational. And Lord, will long outlive our lifetime. And Lord, the future of this church really does depend on this. And so I understand the sobriety of this subject matter. And Father, I pray that it will be well received. And that, Father, it would be acted upon. Lord, I admit my shortcoming in really being an authority on this. So today I stand as a growing humble servant that just chooses to be your voice box. So say what you need to say in Jesus' name. Amen. You're in Matthew chapter 19. I want to read beginning at verse 1. I would invite you to follow along. The Bible says, "Now when Jesus had finished these sayings, he went away from Galilee and entered the region of Judea beyond the Jordan. And large crowds followed him, and he healed them there. The Pharisees came up to him and tested him by asking, 'Is it lawful to divorce one's wife for any cause?' He answered, 'Have you not read that he who created them from the beginning made them male and female?' And he said, 'Therefore a man shall leave his father and mother and shall hold fast to his wife, and the two shall become one flesh. So they are no longer two, but one. What therefore God is joined together, let no man separate.'" Years ago, is a 24-year-old naive young man. I stood at an altar, I believe in Peterborough, New Hampshire, and married Amy. So the bride, there you go, the bride, get that right, all right, beautiful Amy, the groom with a nice donut head, Kevin, stood at an altar, and her father, Pastor Carl Nannini, stood right in between us. And I remember talking with Pastor Nannini about marrying his daughter. I feared him. I was afraid of him. And to this day, I fear him. And I still am afraid of him. And I will never forget the look in his eyes as he walked his daughter down the aisle, and I stood there in amazement and stood at an altar 23 years ago, 24 years old, not really knowing what I was committing to, and I know my wife didn't know what she was committing to. And through that journey, and in that moment, something significant happened that really wasn't the doing of Pastor Carl. It wasn't the doing of a wedding ring or a license from the state of New Hampshire. What happened is this mysterious thing that God describes in Ephesians, where literally a man and a woman, two individuals, become one. And so on that day, June 7th, 1991, Kevin and Amy Carr came one. And I'm sure you remember your day. You have pictures maybe around the house. You have thoughts of when you made that commitment. And what I have discovered since that day is, and I would say this because I know who I am, not because of the woman that I married, the marriage has been hard. That there have been incredible challenges. And that I know this, if you've been married for any length of time, and as I interact and sit with people, that every single one of you that have done this know what I'm talking about. There have been days in marriage, all of us can attest to, where you really just wonder, am I really able to do this? Can it get better? And today what I want to do is I want to just share from my heart and from the scriptures an incredibly compelling reason why your marriage is so much bigger than you. But there, this row right here needs you to stay married. This building that you're in, this place called Rock Prairie, needs you to stay married. Bigger than that, listen to me. God's glory and God's name is at stake. And none of us realized truly the extent of the commitment we were making. But you made it. You made it to your spouse. You made it to your God. You made it to your family. And so today, I just want to talk to you very plainly about why your marriage matters so much. Why our church stands. And I don't know if you realize, the pastoral staff does, there is an incredible intense pressure outside, and listen to me, even inside, to kind of shrink back from the truth of what God says about marriage. And if our church is not a building, it is families. The foundation of this church is your marriage. Our church is only as strong, men, as you choose to love your wife. Our church is only as strong, ma'am, as you choose to love and respect and submit to your husband. And it's serious business. It is a big deal. And as I was reading through Ephesians, it talks about this, that God doesn't want us to entertain the thoughts of deception, but he wants us to expose the lies. And today I want to talk very pointedly and very precisely from the scriptures some lies that have crept in to the thinking and the mindset of people that claim to know Jesus as their Savior. And I want you to hear, not me, I want you to hear the Word. And with these lies, I want to give you the truth found in Scripture, of why it is worth it. Why years ago when you made that promise and through the trials and sufferings that your family has been through and the financial setbacks and the unexpected health occurrences and the intentional pain that you have caused one another in your marriage, and it happens, why still saying I do is worth it. And so I want to do that by talking about some lies. And again, I just want to approach this incredibly seriously, and here's why. Because I had this sermon all set Thursday night, and I was watching the Alabama game. And I just was unsettled that there were some things I soft-pedaled. And so I came back in at 9 o'clock and found Lisa and Andy working on what we're about to enjoy in a few minutes. But I just could not. I don't want to get up here. I don't want to do it halfway. You deserve it. And so I would encourage you, especially you guys down here, I would take some notes, because if you're even contemplating marriage, I would write this stuff down, because you're going to face it. So let's talk about some lies and the truths that go with it, why staying married matters to God. And here's why it's so hard. It's not because of the woman I picked. It's because Satan doesn't want you to be married. Satan wants to divide you. So when you and your wife argue, you are not arguing with your wife. The Bible says in Ephesians, we don't battle with flesh and blood. There's a scheme behind it. There's a reason behind it. There's a motive behind it. There's an intense power behind it that is so beyond your capacity to resist on your own. And so the way that Satan divides families is through deceiving us. It's you and I, in the midst of frustration or unfulfilled expectation, just embracing a deceitful lie that is sent straight from the pit of hell. And when you and I embrace this deception, hear me out, your marriage will unravel right in front of you, right before you. And you'll feel like it's like a roller coaster going downhill, that there is nothing you can do to stop it. And so today, for God's glory and by His grace, I want us, followers of Jesus, to reclaim the truth and the beauty and the glory and the mystery of what marriage is. And beyond knowing it, living it, of which I fail often. Line number one, write this down. This is outside our church and it's crept inside our church. This is truth. Marriage, the lie, by God's design, is an archaic institution irrelevant for modern intelligent people. Let me repeat that. Marriage, by God's design, is an archaic institution irrelevant for modern enlightened people. It was interesting. In November of 2010, Time had on its cover of its magazine this question: does marriage matter? Is marriage worth it? Who needs to be married? They had a picture of a bride and groom walking down the aisle. Really what spurred this article, and again, very secular, was that they polled kind of our society, and at 44% of people 30 and under said, you know what, I think it's best just not to get married. And I think over time, as generations go by, that eventually marriage by God's design, as God has spoken in His book, really is going to be extinct. It's going to be kind of a thing you go to a museum and read about, kind of a historical artifact where a man would marry a woman and they would remain sexually pure with one another and they would engage in this journey of life for the rest of their life till they die. The 30 and under, half of them think, you know what, it's really just antiquated, it's outdated, it's not really up with the times, and honestly, only unintelligent, desperate people who can't cope with life need to partner with someone to help them. It's a crutch. This is mind-boggling, though. But 95% of them wanted to be married. Now get that, right? I don't think it's going to work, but I want it. And here's why. That's the way God wired us, didn't He? Because when He saw Adam in the Garden of Eden, He said, it's not good that you're alone. And He made a wife, a female, Eve. And the Bible says that when they come together, there's this union that is far more powerful than a license distributed by Tipton County. It's far more than a minister saying, I now pronounce you husband and wife. There's something mystical and divine where God takes two souls and one plus one somehow, and it's indescribable, and our little finite minds can't get around it. But two become one. Forever. And the reason marriage actually is important, and the reason marriage will never go away, is because God invented it. In Genesis chapter 2, He said, He created man and woman, and for this cause a man leaves his father and mother, and they become one. And it's in God's design before the fall. This is a picture, Ephesians tells us. It is the only picture. It is the most vivid picture. It is three-dimensional of Jesus' love for you. And that is why every time divorce happens, it hurts God. Because that is the picture of Jesus' love for us. His undying, unrelentless, bottomless, grace-filled love extended to you and I. And the Bible says it is what you chose to do. That illustrates it. That pictures it. That demonstrates it. But bigger than that, your marriage is a whole lot bigger than your happiness. It's a whole lot. It cannot be contained just to the 40, 50, 60 years that you're married. Your marriage ultimately is a picture of God's glory. It gives Him glory. We're two incompatible people. You are incompatible. You're sinful and you're selfish. You're messed up. And somehow God in His grace, as we look to Him and receive grace and love from Him, and we pour that into our spouse, there's no explanation. How can two incredibly selfish, difficult people who love Jesus somehow not only just remain married, but produce offspring that love Jesus,
follow in the path of Christ and impact God's kingdom together. And so I wholeheartedly disagree with what our culture says, with the author of the Time magazine article, that marriage is for God's people. It will not go extinct, and it matters. Now, let me say this. I know there are people here today that you have been through the pain of divorce. And the last thing I want you to walk out of here is feeling condemned and unloved. Look at me. God hates divorce. He loves divorced people. Amen? He does. He does. But today I am speaking specifically to those marriages, to those people where in the back of your mind you're wondering, is this really worth it? Can I really do this? Should I even try anymore? Line number one is marriage really is irrelevant and is going to be extinct. Write this down. Line number two, your spouse will complete you. It goes like this. Parts of you that are lacking needs to be completed. Find the right person that will complement you and perfect you. And guess what? Jackpot. You got the right one. See, if you can go to the next slide, the thinking is that when we come into marriage, that I have found this one that makes me feel so good. She's going to make me feel this way all the time. That, man, she is cute. And when you married that 180-pound guy 20 years ago, you're expecting him to be 180 25 years later. Ain't going to happen, sweetheart, right? You're thinking that when we get married, there's going to be birds chirping. And as we hold hands walking through the mall, the soundtrack of Lionel Richie is going to be in the background, right? And then when I get home and get in the bedroom and shut the door, all of a sudden, waha, it's Barry White, right? Over the loudspeaker. And probably a few days into your marriage, you realize it's not Lionel Richie, it's not Barry White, it's Crazy Train by Ozzy Osbourne, right? That I didn't sign up for this. That she hasn't completed me. Let me say this, that the scriptures tell us that God gave us his creation to enjoy, not to complete you. That, and this almost ruined my marriage. To lay the weight of your wife to fix you, to please you, and to cater to your desires will eventually snuff out any romance, joy, and happiness your marriage will ever know. Your spouse will not complete you. Only Jesus Christ will. The truth is, as you bring your spouse into your world, your spouse will complicate your situation. And it doesn't matter who that spouse is, because when you bring two sinners that by nature are selfish, it is going to force you to make a decision to selflessly serve and sacrificially love or demand your way right out of that covenant marriage. And so the fact that your spouse cannot complete you, well then, how do I fix me? How do I make myself right? Paul addresses this in Ephesians 3, so that Christ may dwell in your hearts through faith. And I pray that you, being rooted and established in love, may have power together with all the Lord's holy people to grasp how wide, how long, how high and deep is the love of Christ, and to know this love that surpasses knowledge, that you may be filled to the measure of all fullness of God. The only person that can fix you is Jesus, not your spouse. The only person that can make up for your inadequacies, that can help your just poor view of yourself and address the past in the dysfunctional family you grew up in, that is not your spouse's responsibility. They are incapable of doing that. It's Jesus. But here's the beauty of this. That when I take my brokenness and I surrender it under the cross of Jesus Christ and he pours out grace to meet me right at my mess, he enables me in my mess to love my spouse. And the mistake that I made for years, and at times it's my default button, is to expect my wife to compensate, to fix, to come alongside, to make me better. She can't, because I'm far too messed up beyond Amy's capacity to fix me. Amen? The nod, the polite nod. Thank you, sweetie, for being so gracious. And when you do that, your marriage won't make it. Because you lay on your spouse a pressure that is just too hard to live with. But when you say, God, I am broken and I can't fix me and I need you to help me, and God in his spirit pours out his love and his grace in your life, all of a sudden, those inadequacies by God's grace actually become your strengths that you then can begin to pour into your family. It's amazing. I see it all the time. But don't believe the lie that your spouse is there completely, because what you'll do is you'll discover that they can't, and then you'll move from this person to this person to this person, and the tragedy of all tragedies at the end of your life, you'll realize, no one else could fix me. I wonder what's wrong with them. When in reality, the problem was with me, trying to find in people what I can only find in a Savior. Lie number three, it gets even more personal. Here you go. You too can handle this on your own. Right? Hey, let's just be honest. What was your hardest year of marriage? You're like 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, right? What was your hardest year of marriage? And here is the lie. This is why church sometimes is so fake, so phony. We walk in here and we can be fighting like cats and dogs. We can have a knockdown drag out. You have insulted your wife. She has insulted you back. And we walk in those doors and flip the switch, right? How are you doing? Oh, we're great. We're praying 5 times together. We memorize Deuteronomy 8, right? We say the Lord's Prayer before supper. We do all that. You liar. And here is the truth, that when our marriages go south, I've seen it over and over, that we kind of isolate ourselves. Proverbs says, a fool isolates themselves to destruction. Here's how it goes. You start having some tension in your marriage. It's not going well. You don't go to small group anymore. You know why? You don't want to sit in a circle with people that know you enough that are going to speak truth into your life. And if you're really proud enough to think that you can do your marriage by yourself, God didn't design it that way. It's in a community of loving believers. As you sit and you fellowship and you counsel and you advise one another, that is how you ensure, and guys, you know this, we're minutes away from blowing up everything that we love and value out of our own selfishness. God says you can't do it alone. And so you disconnect from small group. You disconnect from church. You disconnect from one another. And as I mentioned in the beginning, you start to believe the lies that this marriage is hopeless. It's not fixable. I don't want to hear it. It's not my problem. It's because of her. It's because of job. It's because of health. It's because we don't have sex anymore. And you know what? I'm done. I'm done. Ecclesiastes says, two are better than one, because if one falls, the other will do what? You guys have so isolated yourself from people that we don't even know you've fallen. We can't help you get picked up. Church is a hospital. Church is a place where we're here to help broken marriages. And all of us have had those moments where the door looks very inviting, where you go to the dresser and you start pulling out your socks and underwear and putting it in a bag and think, I'm done. Who is it that you could call when you're contemplating that would be on your doorstep in a matter of minutes and talk you down? If you don't have that couple, if you don't have that person in your life, look at me, your marriage will suffer because of it. Swallow your pride. And get with other couples that you love, that are heading in the same direction. That, you know what, they're messed up like you. But we're messed up together, not apart. You can't do it alone. That's why church is here. That's why we're here. I hate it when people call and say, I know you're busy. I'm not too busy to sit with you and help you learn that you can make it. I know this from personal experience. I am here. I'm still married happily to this woman because of some deacons in our church that love me enough to get intermingled in my mess and talk to me like a man. Tell me men don't treat their wives that way. I am thankful to God for them. They're forever my friends. Do you have that? But why in the world in a place where we should be more open and vulnerable than any place else in the universe, do we fake it? It's pride. You know what it is? It's the lie of Satan. Number four, write this down. Here's the lie. Divorce is an option. Divorce is an option. Matthew 19:3 says, is it lawful to divorce for any cause? Jesus says, have you not read that he who created them from the beginning made them male and female? Therefore, a man shall leave his father and mother and hold fast to his wife, and they shall become one flesh. And so the Bible says they're no longer one flesh. What God has put together, let no man tear asunder. So back to Kevin and Amy. So you have a culture, you have time, you have finances, you have health, you have unfulfilled expectations in the reality of what you're living in. And the gap between that is disappointment. And you start to believe the lie that I can't do this anymore, that there's an out. That, you know what? God's grace forgives, doesn't it? Doesn't it? God doesn't hate divorced people. He loves divorced people. And so why should I live in a miserable marriage for the rest of my life with this constant fighting and this constant frustration that just bubbles inside of me? I'm tired of coming home with this. I'm tired of putting up with him. She spends all our money, and you just go on and on and on. And so how in the world, if God did this, you didn't, a preacher didn't, a marriage license didn't, how then can two that are bound together by God, who created marriage, somehow separate? Let me show you what happens. You try to tear it apart. You try to pull them apart. Divorce stinks. And here's why it stinks. Because it leaves people broken. Leaves people. I can't even begin to describe it. Here's the cool thing. God can take ashes and make them beautiful again. God can take horror and make it something so beautiful that you can't take your eyes off of. Just something that is so grotesque, something that is so painful, something that is so marred. And only God can do it. In his grace, he can just make beautiful things. And there are people here today that are divorced, and God has done that in your life. But know this, that when a couple chooses to say, I can't, I'm done, I'm gone, it's over. It doesn't just impact you. It impacts your kids. Because the way God made it in Deuteronomy chapter 6, that you are the most powerful spiritual influence more than you could even imagine. And kids, marital difficulty is complicated. You can't ask a 16-year-old to understand why. You can't ask a 12-year-old to understand why you mom and dad are just done. And so if you're here and your marriage is on life support and it is struggling and you are so frustrated that you are ready to try to undo what God did when you made the promise to him, just know this, your life will never, ever be the same. I remember I was talking to a guy in our church. His kid was in our youth group. And here's what he says. He says, you know what? I'm going to divorce in the child's name's mom. And here's the truth. They'll be okay. They'll be okay. I said, you know what? Yeah, they will with God's grace, but here's what it's going to be like. It's like they went to a trauma and they were taken down to Methodist and they're sewn up, and somehow with the skill of these master physicians, they sew them back up. But you know what? They're always going to have scars. And right now, while you have the opportunity to do an unselfish act and follow Jesus, do you want on your conscience the scars that you will forever put upon your son? He didn't answer me. He got up and walked out. They're back together. It's like this. Let me use the football analogy. Praise God, Alabama got beat yesterday. There is a God. But anyways, sorry, Alabama fans. But if you're standing there and there's a 250-pound running back running through the hole, and you're a 200-pound defensive back, if you just go 98% at that hole to plug that hole, what's going to happen to you? You're going to get run over. You're going to get rolled over. You're going to be dust. The only way you can tackle that object, that 250-pound freight train, is even though you weigh less, with 100% total commitment, all in, you commit yourself to that hole and you jack him up and you knock his helmet off and you get up and, I got issues, don't I, right? Unsportsmanlike conduct. Look at me, that is the same way you ought to wake up every morning with your marriage. That there is this army that wants me to walk out, to quit, to pack my bags, to pack it in. I am going to hit that hole 100% and I'm going to win. I'm going to stay married. If in the back of your mind you have this thought that if this doesn't work out, it's okay to walk out, your marriage is suffering right now, even if it's an option. I'm so thankful I married Amy Carr, Amy Nannini. She grew up in a home where divorce is not an option. If it was even remotely an option, I am confident my wife would have left a long time ago. I have given her ample reasons why. But because of her commitment to Jesus Christ, she's decided to hit the hole 100%. Divorce isn't an option. In Matthew chapter 5, there's an exception for adultery. In 1 Corinthians 7, there's an exception where a non-believer abandons a believer, and God grants divorce and remarriage. He does. But what's happened in the pressure because of our culture is we have dumbed down the meaning of marriage and divorce is because we're incompatible, because we don't get along, because we don't like each other. That's a lie from the pit of hell. Amen? It is. It is. It is. And our kids need to hear it. And look at me. They need to see it. That marriage is so important. I'm not quitting. When it gets hard, I'm going to fight for our marriage. I'm not going to fight against my spouse. Line number 5. Almost done. The kids will be better off if we split up. Kids will be better off if we split up. After all, God wouldn't want his kids to see what's going on in our home. No, your kids need to see that in the midst of your messy marriage, that you love God and you're committed enough to your wife that you will do everything it takes to stay married. Your kids need to see, and this positions them well for the future, that marriage is not happily ever after. That is not true. It's Disney. There's joy in it. There's wonderful pleasure in it. There's incredible excitement in it. I wouldn't trade my marriage to Amy for anything. But in that relationship, we both have experienced the greatest joys and at the same time, the greatest pains. And so even in the mess, your kids are better off you being married to your spouse. Amen? They are. You know what? Mom and dad are the rock. Everything else is chaotic in this world. Everything else doesn't make sense. Everything else is discombobulated. But you know what? My mom and dad, when I come home, they're together. They're going to be there. They're going to stay that way. There's a confidence that comes from your kids believing that. Let me ask you, do your kids know that? That, hey, no matter what, mom and dad had a little argument. Dad was being a bonehead again. I know, all right? But we're good. We're going to stay together. Line number 5. Actually, line number 6, excuse me. Last one. This marriage is hopeless. You ever thought that? You ever walk out? Did you ever spend a night on the couch? Don't raise your hand. I have. Did you ever think, you know what? This has just cascaded so far down that there's just no way. She has said things and done things. He has said things and done things. It can never be undone. That's absolutely true. But you know what? This marriage is beyond hope. I love this verse in Joel chapter 2. It says this, and the Lord will restore the years that the locust have eaten. When you, as a Christ follower, I'm talking to Jesus followers today, in your marriage, say, this is beyond the point of no return, this is hopeless, you are saying that God is incapable of doing the miraculous. And Paul, over and over in the New Testament, says, with God, all things are what? And some of you are here today and you're sitting next to your spouse because you believe that during that horrible, difficult season in your marriage. There's hope. And hope begins with your spouse not changing. The hope begins with you deciding that I made a promise 23 years ago and I still do. I still do choose to be married to my spouse. And the lie that's crept in under the doors of the church is this, is that it's love that sustains the promise. It is the promise that sustains the love. You remember when you first realized, can I trade this one in? What if marriage was like cell phones every 2 years, right? You know, get the latest and greatest model, get a skinnier one, a taller one, a more fit one, right? When you said, I do, it was for the rest of your life in that covenant commitment. Look at me. It's worth it. I made a little video that kind of tracks the course of marriage. I want you to watch it with me. promise years ago. For better, for worse, for richer, for poorer, in sickness and in health, to love and to keep you. To be one. Till death do us part. Today, what I want you to do is I want to give you an opportunity to affirm that promise that you made. That regardless of what happens financially, that, you know what, I don't know what our future is going to hold. It's not going to be easy. Health may fail. But here's one thing I know. That no matter what we go through, I'm going to spend the rest of my life with you. And today, I affirm what I said years ago. I choose you. I do. And I'm not going to let my selfishness, I'm not going to let our culture, I'm not going to let what other people think or say get in between us. Because you're worth it. You're my bride. You're my husband. You're my gift. And today, I choose you. So here's what I want you to do. It's a big deal. It's a big deal, not just for you. It's a big deal for this group of kids up here to see that, you know what, marriage still matters. It's still important. That it is possible for a man and woman to stand at an altar and make a promise and keep it till they die. Even when it's tested. Even when it's pushed to the limit. So if you're here with your spouse, I want you to stand up. If you're willing to reaffirm the fact that you still do, stand up. For those of you, some are here and your spouse isn't here, you stand up too. And by standing here today, what you're saying is, I choose, even with all the mess that I am and all the stuff we're going to face, that you're worth it, that you matter, that I love you and I love Jesus, and I'm going to keep my covenant commitment. It's tested, isn't it? You know, I imagine what keeps Amy going is years from now we're going to be sitting on a porch in a rocking chair. I have this thought. It's just getting old. And David is going to walk by with his wife and his seven children. And I just, you know, and seeing them. And then Michael's going to come with his girls. And one of his boys, he said, is going to name Jesus. I don't know how that's going to work. But, you know, Jesus is going to sit on the lap of grandma and grandpa. And you know what? We're going to think about those days where we were just so tempted and we were just that close to walk away. And as I hold those grandkids and I see my son's family, I'm going to look into my wife's eye and say, it was worth it, wasn't it? All the crap you had to put up with me, it was worth it, wasn't it? All the stuff we just chose to say, we're not ending this. It's worth it. Let me pray with you. God, thank you today for spouses. Father's a man, I know I don't deserve her. She is a gift from you. And Father, when you and your sovereignty brought us together, it was more than just Kevin and Amy. It was about your glory. It was about building your kingdom. It was about bringing children into this world, Father. It was about raising a godly legacy. And Father, there are people standing here today that are doing that. And Father, they face the forces and the pressure and the temptation, Lord, to just quit, to selfishly give in, to cave. Father, I pray today that, Father, this reaffirmation of I still do, this commitment, Father, this week will carry them through, that, God, you would make their marriages stronger. You have not asked us, God, to stay in a miserable marriage, but, Father, rather to begin a new marriage with a person that we chose to make a promise to. And so, God, with my hand lifted high by your grace, I pray that would be true on all of these couples. Father, for our young people that are even considering marriage, I pray that they would choose wisely and that they would understand with all of their heart that it is bigger than their happiness. It is about your kingdom and your glory. Father, today we celebrate the gift of marriage, the beauty of covenant relationship, that God pictures your love for us. And Father, today as we reaffirm the promise we made years ago, we desperately need your grace to live it out. So help us, we pray, in Jesus' glorious name. Amen.